Praise the Lord. Amen. Thankful to the Lord for this wonderful time of worship has given to us. Especially it's so wonderful to feel the presence of God this morning, all throughout our worship. And I'm thankful to the Lord for the deliverance that He's doing in our midst. Maybe see more in the days to come. For a few minutes of thought this morning, let's turn our Bibles to the book of Lamentations. I'm going to read for you from chapter 3, verses 21 through 24. Those of you who are struggling to find Lamentations in your Bible, go to Psalm, then go to the right a little bit, you find Isaiah, Jeremiah. After Jeremiah and before Ezekiel, you will find the book of Lamentations. Otherwise, they might be spending the whole time looking for it while I'm trying to preach. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 21 through 24. And the Bible reads, "Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for Him. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For His compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness." Praise God. If you were reading this portion of scripture, apart from the context of this passage, you would think that this is probably taken from one of the Psalms. But when you study the book of Lamentations, it is a book that is filled with the cry of a man who only did crying in his life. In the midst of all of his crying, here, right there, smack in the middle of this book, He turns to us and gives us wonderful truths about the God that He serves. The man that I'm talking about is a man by the name of Jeremiah. The Bible tells us that Jeremiah was a prophet of God, born to a priestly family. His father, Hilkiah, was a priest. And the only good thing that happened in the life of Jeremiah that I can see is the call of God that came to his life. In Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5, God's word came to him, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Again, the word of God came to him when he was hesitant to speak, further reaffirming the call of God in his life. The good news in the life of Jeremiah ended with the first words he ever heard from God. "Before you were formed in your mother's womb, I knew you. You were set apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." I wonder if Jeremiah often thought, "God, I wish you never saw me before I was formed in my mother's womb." His life was a life that was filled with constant pain, sorrow, and tragedy. He prophesied for more than 48 years in his life, did not see any kind of meaningful change in the people that he was ministering to. Imagine preaching to a group of people, the same people, for 48 years and not having any change happen to them. I don't think any pastor will last in their ministry that long. Jeremiah prophesied for 48 very long years. The people only wanted to listen to those false prophets who told them that everything was good and that God was on their side. Even though he was a servant of God, his own family rejected him. His relatives turned against him. He was specifically told by the Lord not to marry, not to have any children. As such, he did not even have any close relatives on the face of the earth. He could not go to any party because God specifically told him, "I don't want you to go to any house of feasting." He could never worship properly because God told him, "I don't want you to go to the temple either." Basically, a socially isolated, all alone, just given to drown in his tears and sorrow in his life. What about the political structure of that time? About 100 years before even Jeremiah started prophesying, the Assyrians had come and conquered the northern kingdom of Israel along with the 10 tribes. They took them as captives, never to be found again, lost in the annals of history. Over and over again, God sent prophets to the southern kingdom of Judah with his two tribes to remind them, Don't do the same things that your brothers did and have the same consequence happen to your life. But they never listened and they continued in their wicked ways of rebelling against the God that they should have served. God, he started prophesying in the 13th year of King Josiah, who was a godly king that God had given to the people of Judah. But after Josiah died, the one who came after him, his second son, Jehoahaz, only ruled for just a very short period of time. He was an evil man. He only reigned for 3 months and he was taken and died in captivity under the Pharaoh of Egypt. The next king to came on the rule is a man by the name of Jehoiakim, who ruled for 11 years. He was a puppet in the hands of the Egyptian kingdom and then again in the Babylonian kingdom. Eventually, he also revolted and carried off, and he was died in captivity. Jehoiakim ruled after that for 3 months. He was a political prisoner in Babylon for more than 37 years. And then came Zedekiah, the final king of Judah, who ruled during the time Nebuchadnezzar finally laid hold of siege on the town of Jerusalem. Over and over again, Jeremiah told him, it is better for you to surrender because there is no escaping this. The people of God are supposed to be taken as captives to Babylon. But he would not listen. 2 years of siege, hundreds and thousands of people died in famine inside the city of Jerusalem. Finally, Zedekiah was captured. His own children were killed right in front of his eyes. He was blinded and taken as captive to Babylon. Why did I give you all this long history of all these kings? Nothing in the religious establishment to comfort the heart of Jeremiah. Nothing in the political establishment to give him hope in his life. No friends, no relatives. He was often tortured, beaten. Once he was lowered into a muddy cistern where he drowned in the mud and was left there to starve himself to death. He was put in the prison of the king, tortured and beaten. And even when his very prophecy that he had been prophesying for 48 years came true, Jeremiah was a prisoner in the prison of the king. A life filled with sorrow. The Bible says every time he talked, he cried. The Bible says he became a laughing stock all the day long, where people would make fun of him. He was a man given to much sorrow, given him the apt title, the weeping prophet. Not only that, he saw thousands of people being taken away as captives. Jewish tradition tells us that Jeremiah finally ended up in Egypt, where he was stoned to death. Hardly the life of a man who was called by God even before he was formed in the womb of his mother. If you were to look at the life of this man, you would look at that and say, what a tragic life. You would even say, what did he do or his parents do that he deserved so much pain in his life? Oftentimes, when we go through periods of sorrow in our life, when we go through sickness in our life, the world might look at it and say, I wonder what he did that all of these troubles are happening to him. Jeremiah's life would have been just like that. In the eyes of the world, he was a total failure. But then, seeing the multitude of people being taken away as captives, he says to us in Lamentations, which is the cry of the prophet as he sees his own prophecy being fulfilled. He is not rejoicing that his prophecy finally came true. He is crying out for his people. But then he says, this I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope in my life. And here is what this is. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. Hallelujah. They are new every morning. Hallelujah. Great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. A man given to so much sorrow, so much pain, so much suffering. How can he sing the song that says, my Lord is compassionate, my Lord is loving, great is the faithfulness of my God. Hallelujah. Only the Christian can have such a song in the middle of the night. Hallelujah. Only the Christian can have such incredible perspective on life that the world could never give to him. Hallelujah. Even when it seems like God has forgotten him, he sings of the love, the compassion, and the faithfulness of his God. What strengthened Jeremiah in the midst of the sufferings of his life? The first thing that strengthened Jeremiah is this. Jeremiah was strengthened by the thought that God is the sovereign creator of everything. In Jeremiah chapter 32 verse 17, he says, "Oh sovereign Lord," hallelujah, "you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you." The realization that my God made everything strengthened Jeremiah in his life. How is the realization that God is our creator supposed to strengthen us in our life? If God is my creator, guess what? Everything that happens in my life is ordained and planned by my loving God who made me in my image. If I am just a product of chance and time, like the world would have you believe, then everything that happens in my life is only by chance and random, and as such, I need to find meaning in the midst of the sufferings of my life. But if I know that God made me and God knew me before I was formed in my mother's womb, I also know one thing: He will never bring any suffering into my life that I'm not able to bear. He knows exactly what I can endure, even in the midst of the suffering of my life. I know that the name of my Lord can be glorified. Amen. All the philosophies, all the teachings of this world will have you believe that we are here just by chance. Hallelujah. That is the religion of this world. Whereas the Bible, from the beginning verse all the way to the end, makes it very clear: in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Hallelujah. It is important that you and I believe in the Creator God that we worship. The monarch butterfly is one of the most amazing creature in all of God's creation. This is a creature so beautifully made in orange and black, for which science have no answer. The way it is formed, the way it lives its life, is still a mystery to science. But one aspect about the monarch butterfly is something so phenomenally amazing. This is what it is. See, the monarch butterfly first has its origin in the cold Nova Scotia region of Canada. There, they go through three generations where they only live for about 2 to 6 weeks. After 2 to 6 weeks, another generation is born, and then the third generation comes. By the time the fourth generation comes, towards the month of September and October, when it starts to get really cold in Canada, these small butterflies does something amazing that is a wonder to the world of science. In order to escape the cold wintry months of Canada, every monarch butterfly that is east of the Rocky Mountains will make this trip and travel more than 3,000 miles and go to the exact place in a mountain in Mexico every single year. People will go there every single year to see more than 300 million of these butterflies make the migratory journey over a span of 6 to 8 weeks, travel more than 3,000 miles and come to this mountains of Mexico. It is only in the fourth generation of monarch butterfly, they live for 6 to 8 months, whereas the first three generations only live 6 to 8 weeks. Science does not have an answer for that, as to why only the fourth generation survive for 6 to 8 months. The reason for that is because they have to make this journey all the way to Mexico. Not only that, they have to go into hibernation, where they will live there until springtime comes back in Canada. Then they will lay their eggs, they will die, and a new generation will spring up that will travel all the way back to Canada, to the exact place where their parents came from. Oftentimes, these butterflies that travel come to the exact same tree that their four generations ago traveled to. How do they do that? Hallelujah. They thought that they look to the sun, and by the position of the sun, they travel without veering off course for thousands of miles. In order for them to do this, they have to have an almanac on the inside of them that tell them the direction of where they are based upon the position of the sun. They have to have a computer inside their head that direct them in the specific direction they should go. by the course of wind and for food. Sometimes they veer off in their specific way they're going, but they get back on the way, and every single one of them, not single one of them lost, will end up in the mountains of Mexico, traveling more than 3,000 miles. They have a map inside of them, they have a computer inside of them, and they have all these things that guide them precisely to go to the exact tree where the generations came from just a year ago. And you want me to believe that all of these things happen by chance? I don't have as much faith as you do. I rather believe that my God created them and put inside of them a compass that the world has not been able to find, by which these tiny creatures travel, and they come on top of these trees, often 100,000 of them just on one tree. 40 acres of land in Mexico holds more than 300 million of the monarch butterfly. The migration of the monarch butterfly is no accident. It is given to us to show to us the immense point of the fact that our God is the one who created the heavens and the earth, and everything is indeed the work of his hands. Not only did Jeremiah know that God created everything, he also knew that God is the omnipotent deliverer of his life. Hallelujah. He says in Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 27, "Oh, I am the Lord, the God of all mankind." Hallelujah. "Is there anything that is too hard for me?" Hallelujah. "I am the Lord, the God of all mankind. Is there anything that is too hard for you?" Maybe you are thinking this morning, "My circumstance is too hard for me to, for the Lord to rectify." I have good news for you. God is asking you this morning, "I am the Lord, the God of all mankind. Is there anything that is too hard for me?" Amen. Hallelujah. There is nothing that is impossible to our God. Jeremiah knew that even if these people are taken away as captives, one day they will come back to their promised land. One day they will once again worship here. Hallelujah. "So I will serve my God faithfully, even if I will not be alive to see the fulfillment of God's promises." Not only that, Jeremiah was not only strengthened by the fact that God is our creator, Jeremiah was not only strengthened by the fact that God is our omnipotent deliverer. Lastly, Jeremiah was strengthened by the fact that God is the ever-present help in time of need. Hallelujah. God is our ever-present help in time of need. Hallelujah. In Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 24, the Bible says, "Can anyone hide in secret places so that I cannot see him, declares the Lord? Do not I fill the heaven and earth, declares the Lord." You think your sorrow is unknown to the Lord. The Lord reminds you this morning, there is nothing, hallelujah, that escapes the eye or the presence of the Almighty God that we worship. Hallelujah. That's why we sang this morning, every breath, every tear, every prayer, he sees every single one of them, and not for a moment, hallelujah, did he forsake you in your life. Hallelujah. Even when we thought that he was 1,000 miles away, hallelujah, he was all alone, holding you in the palm of his hands. Hallelujah. Our everlasting God, the omnipotent deliverer, hallelujah, he is also an omnipresent God. Hallelujah. Jeremiah knew that in his life. Hallelujah. Because of faith like this, men and women over the ages have been able to serve God even in the midst of the tragedies of their life. Hallelujah. Many a times you have heard quotes from a theologian by the name of B.B. Warfield. Many of us learn about his theology in our Bible schools. Benjamin Breckinridge Warfield, hallelujah, a very prominent theologian who taught at Princeton for more than 37 years of his life. He was well known and he was very well versed in God's word. But many people do not know what happened to his life at a very, very young age. After he married his wife Annie, and they were going to Germany to celebrate their honeymoon. While they were on their honeymoon, they were struck and caught in a thunderstorm. There in that thunderstorm, his wife was struck by lightning that would paralyze her for the rest of her life. She was an invalid where this great pastor theologian had to take care of her every single day of her life until her death in 1915. He could never leave his house for more than 2 hours at a time. because he had to take care of his wife who was paralyzed. But he never complained. He faithfully served his loving God, writing so many books and bringing us so much profound theology from the Word of God. He never used it as an excuse to get away, shy away from his work that the Lord had entrusted to him. This is what he says. The fundamental thought is the universal government of God. All that comes to you is under his controlling hand. The secondary thought is the favor of God to those who that love him. Based on Romans chapter 8 verse 28, he writes, though we are too weak to help ourselves and too blind to ask for what we need and can only groan in unformed longings, he is the author in us of these very longings, he says. If God governs all, then nothing but good can befall those to whom he would do good. Do you hear what I said? If God governs all, then only good can come to those who are loved by him and who are known by him. So even the sufferings that come in our life, God has a purpose behind it, and there is something that God wants to accomplish in it. In it also, God is absolutely good and loving towards you. Do not doubt the goodness of my God. Hallelujah. Corrie ten Boom. You all know the story of Corrie ten Boom. If you ever read the book Hiding Place or watched the movie The Hiding Place, it tells a story of a loving Christian family who took on Jewish people who were about to be led to the brutality of Holocaust to be killed. They hid many Jewish people in their basement for many years. Finally, they were caught, and Corrie ten Boom, even though they were not Jewish, along with her sister Betsy and her father, was taken to the concentration camp. And there, she saw the death of her father. Finally, it was Corrie ten Boom all alone with her sister. She said, laying in that concentration camp, in a place filled with so much darkness, so much disease, and so much the smell of death all around us, there was darkness all around us, and there was darkness in my heart. My sister Betsy was starving to death right beside me, with me unable to even give her anything to eat. I saw the death of my sister Betsy. As she lay there dying, I turned to her and said, Betsy, I think the Lord has forgotten us. She turned to her and says, Corrie, do not say that. As far and high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love to those who fear him. Amen. Even in the midst of the concentration camp, the Christian says, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love towards those who fear him. She writes more and she says, there is an ocean of God's love available. There is plenty for everyone. May God grant you never to doubt that victorious love under whatever circumstances you face in your life. As I end this morning, you know what I think really strengthened Jeremiah in his life? Even though I don't know if he fully understood all the implications of what he was prophesying, it is this verse in Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 5 through 6. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will rise up to David a righteous branch. Hallelujah. When Jeremiah looked all around him, all he saw was the religious establishment falling apart. All he saw was the political establishment falling apart. But then the word of God came to him by the Spirit of God. Eventually, a righteous branch out of David will come into this world. His name is the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. In the midst of the fallen kings around you, he will reign as the righteous king in all the universe. In the midst of the false prophets around you, he will be a faithful prophet. In the midst of the priests who do not know how to worship God, he will be our high priest forever. Hallelujah. In the midst of sacrifices that are not able to take your sins away, he will die, and with his death, he will wash all your sins away. Yes, a righteous branch will come, and it is the Lord Jesus Christ. Furthermore, he says, in his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. Hallelujah. This is the name by which he'll be called, the Lord our righteousness. Not only that, he will do something else. He will put his law in their minds and write it on their hearts. No longer will the law be written on tablets anymore. No longer will the law be written on pieces of paper anymore. It will be written in the hearts and minds of people. When did that happen? It happened on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came with power and fell upon each person Spirit of God, the very day that they would celebrate the giving of the law on Mount Sinai, the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit brought the new covenant into the hearts and minds of the believers that came together on that day. Now, what governs us is not the written law. What governs us is the law of the Spirit that is able to rule us in our hearts. Not only that, because His righteous branch comes, He will not only put His law in our hearts, they will all know Me. The Son of God will come down into this world. He will live as a man so we can know more about God. And not only that, I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. God will take away all the sins and wickedness through the death of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary. Because of the Lord Jesus Christ, Jeremiah will rise again. Because of the Lord Jesus Christ, Jeremiah will come before His Heavenly Father. And there, in as we sang this morning, hallelujah, Tamil, Tamil, Karnam, Shuthenmar, hallelujah, that beautiful day when the saints shall greet each other, oh, faithful Jeremiah will also come forward to receive his rightful reward from his Creator. And on that day, hallelujah, no one will remember the prophets who falsified prophets of that time, but we will remember Jeremiah forever. Even 2,500 years later, I am still preaching about Jeremiah. Why? Because he was a faithful servant to the call of God in his life, even to the point of his death. Hallelujah. Those who suffer in this world, hallelujah. Paar Marihumi, Kastam Sahikuvil, hallelujah. Nithya Thuramagatha Namadathum, hallelujah. And on that day, hallelujah, we will understand fully and fully well, hallelujah, why we suffered. It is so that we can get a better resurrection. Hallelujah. Do not, hallelujah, measure the success of your life by your 70 or 80 years on this earth. Remember, your life is not from the point of your birth to the point of your death. Your life is from the point of your conception in your mother's womb all the way to eternity that will never end. Measure your success by that measure. Hallelujah. Just like Jeremiah, let's say, the compassions of the Lord never fail. His faithfulness, hallelujah, they are new every morning. Hallelujah. We will continue to praise our God because we know that He is our Creator. We know that He is our Deliverer. And we know that He is our ever-present God. Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Word, Your eternal Word that comes to us in the midst of the sufferings and pain of our life. Thank You for reminding us that no matter what we are going through in our life today, that we serve a God who is our Creator. We serve a God who is our Deliverer. We serve a God and who is our ever-present help. And as the table reminds us this morning, because of the Lord Jesus Christ, we also, like Jeremiah, will rise again. And we will stand before the Lord and we will understand why we suffered the way we suffered on this earth. Ultimately, Lord, we recognize this morning it is all for the glory of our Creator. May the name of the Lord be praised forever and ever. Amen.